Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Magician, a novel. Written by Colm Toibin and read by Gunnar Cauthery.
Chapter 1. Lübeck, 1891. His mother waited upstairs while the servants took coats and scarves and hats from the guests. Until everyone had been ushered into the drawing room, Julia Mann remained in her bedroom. Thomas and his older brother Heinrich and their sisters Lula and Carla watched from the first landing. Soon they knew their mother would appear. Heinrich had to warn Carla to be quiet, or they would be told to go to bed, and they would miss the moment. Their baby brother Victor was sleeping in an upper room. With her hair pinned back severely and tied in a coloured bow, Julia stepped out from her bedroom. Her dress was white, and her black shoes, ordered specially from Mallorca, were simple like a dancer's shoes. She joined the company with an air of reluctance, giving the impression that she had just now been alone with herself in a place more interesting than festive Lübeck. On coming into the drawing room, having glanced around her, Julia would find among the guests one person, usually a man, someone unlikely, such as old Herr Kellinghusen, who was neither young nor old, or Franz Cadovius, his squint inherited from his mother, or Judge August Leverkühn, with his thin lips and clipped moustache. And this man would become the focus of her attention. Her allure came from the atmosphere of foreignness and fragility that she exuded with such charm. Yet there was kindness in her flashing eyes as she asked her guest about work and family and plans for the summer, and, speaking of the summer, she would wish to know about the relative comfort of various hotels in Travemünde. And then she would ask about grand hotels in places as distant as Trouville or Collioure or some resort on the Adriatic. And soon she would pose an unsettling question. She would ask what her interlocutor thought about some normal and respectable woman within their group of associates. The suggestion was that this woman's private life was a matter of some controversy and speculation among the burghers of the town. Young Frau Stavenhitter, or Frau Mackentun, or old Fräulein Distelmann, or someone even more obscure and retiring. And when her bewildered guest would point out that he had nothing other than good to say of the woman, in fact had nothing beyond the very ordinary to transmit, Thomas's mother would express the view that the object of their discussion was, in her considered opinion, a marvellous person, simply delicious, and Lübeck was lucky to have such a woman among its citizens. She would say this as if it were a revelation, something that must stay quite confidential for the moment, something indeed that even her husband, the senator, had not yet been told. The following day, news would spread about their mother's deportment and whom she had singled out for comment, until Heinrich and Thomas would hear about it from their school friends, as if it were a very modern play fresh from Hamburg that had been performed. In the evenings, if the senator were at a meeting, or in the time when Thomas and Heinrich, having done their violin practice and eaten their supper, were in their night clothes, their mother would tell them about the country of her birth, Brazil. A place so vast, she said, that no one knew how many people were there, or what they were like, or what languages they spoke. A country many, many times the size of Germany, where there was no winter and never any frost or real cold, and where one river, the Amazon, was more than 10 times longer than the Rhine and 10 times as wide, with many smaller rivers flowing into it that reached back deep into the forest, with trees higher than trees anywhere else in the world, with people whom no one had ever seen or would see, since they knew the forest as no one else did, and they could hide if an intruder or an outsider came. "Tell us about the stars," Heinrich would say. "Our house in Parati was on the water," Julia would reply. "It was almost part of the water, like a boat. And when night came and we could see the stars, they were bright and low in the sky. Here in the north, the stars are high and distant. In Brazil, they're visible like the sun during the day. They're small suns themselves, glittering and close to us, especially those of us who live near water. My mother said you could sometimes read a book in the upstairs rooms at night because the light from the stars against the water was so clear. And you could not sleep unless you fastened the shutters to keep the brightness out. When I was a girl, the same age as your sisters, I really believed that all the world was like that. The shock on my first night in Lübeck was that I could not see the stars. They were covered over by clouds. Tell us about the ship. You must go to sleep. Tell us the story of all the sugar. Tommy, you know the story of the sugar. But just a small part again? Well, all the marzipan that is made in Lübeck uses sugar that comes from Brazil. Just as Lübeck is famous for marzipan, Brazil is famous for sugar. So, when the good people of Lübeck and their children eat their marzipan on Christmas Eve, little do they know that they are eating a part of Brazil. They are eating sugar that came across the sea just for them. Why don't we make our own sugar? You must ask your father that. Years later, Thomas wondered if his father's decision to marry Julia da Silva Bruns, whose mother was reputed to have had in her veins blood from South American Indians, rather than a stolid daughter of one of the local shipping magnates or old trading and banking families, were not the beginning of the decline of the man's, evidence that a hunger for the richly strange had entered the spirit of the family, which had up to then possessed an appetite only for what was upright and certain to yield a steady return. In Lübeck, Julia was remembered as a small girl arriving with her sister and her three brothers after their mother had died. They were taken care of by an uncle, and they did not, when they appeared first in the city, have a word of German. They were watched suspiciously by figures in the city such as old Frau Overbeck, known for her staunch adherence to the practices of the Reformed Church. "I saw those children blessing themselves one day as they passed the Marienkirche," she said. "It may be necessary to trade with Brazil, but I know no precedent for a Lübeck burgher marrying a Brazilian, none at all." Julia, only 17 at the time of her marriage, gave birth to 5 children who carried themselves with all the dignity required of the children of the senator, but with an added pride and self-consciousness, and something close to display, which Lübeck had not seen before, and which Frau Overbeck and her circle hoped would not become fashionable. Due to this decision to marry unusually, the senator, 11 years older than his wife, was viewed with a certain awe, as though he had invested in Italian paintings or rare majolica, acquired to satisfy a taste that up to then the senator and his antecedents had kept in check. Before leaving for church on Sunday, the man children had to be carefully examined by their father, while their mother delayed them by remaining upstairs in her dressing room, trying on hats or changing her shoes. Heinrich and Thomas had to show a good example by maintaining an expression of gravity, while Lula and Carla tried to stand still. By the time Victor was born, Julia was less attentive to the strictures that her husband laid down. She liked the girls to have colourful bows and stockings, and she did not object to the boys having longer hair and greater latitude in their comportment. Julia dressed elegantly for church, often wearing only one colour, a grey, for example, or a dark blue, with matching stockings and shoes, and the only sign of relief, a red or yellow band on her hat. Her husband was known for the precision of the cuts his tailor in Hamburg made, and for his impeccable appearance. The senator changed his shirt every day, sometimes twice a day, and had an extensive wardrobe. His moustache was trimmed in the French manner. In his fastidiousness, he represented the family firm in all its solidity, a century of civic excellence. But in the luxury of his wardrobe, he offered his own view that being a man in Lübeck meant more than money or trade. It suggested not only sobriety, but a considered sense of style. To his horror, on the short journey between the man's house on Beckergrube and the Marienkirche, Julia often greeted people, gleefully and freely calling out their names, something that had never been done before on a Sunday in the history of Lübeck, further convincing Frau Overbeck and her spinster daughter that Frau Mann was, in her heart at least, still a Catholic. "She is showy and silly, and that is the mark of a Catholic," Frau Overbeck said. "And that band on her hat is pure frivolity." In the Marienkirche itself, as the wider family assembled, it was noted how pale Julia was, and how oddly alluring her pallor was against her heavy chestnut hair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.